Hello and welcome to Streamers and Punches, the podcast from SoundNotionTV that looks at current events and new releases in the world of film music. My name is Bill Witham.
And I'm Kevin Wilt.
And on today's show, we're going to look at some holiday scores, some of our picks for favorite music from movies that have either a Christmas theme or sections that are very obviously influenced by this time of the year. But first, we've got a few headlines. I want to quickly mention a few of these things. First up, James Newton Howard was mentioned recently as a replacement for Danny Elfman on The Hunger Games. So, of course, this is the next series of movies that the studios are hoping will be a big franchise, like a Harry Potter or possibly Twilight, and could have been a big franchise just as well for the composer. But Elfman's schedule ended up being busy, and James Newton Howard has stepped in, and so we're kind of excited about that. I would have been interested to see what Elfman would have done, but we'll find out what James Newton Howard is going to do. Speaking of upcoming projects, there are two different Snow White movies in the works. If anybody who blogs about films or reads about films, you probably are aware of this, but one of them, which is called Mirror, Mirror, is directed by Tarsem Singh, who released the recent Immortals, is sort of a very sort of visual director. Anyway, so his Mirror, Mirror has just locked in Alan Menken to score it, who, of course, is very well known as the basically the composer of the Disney films from arguably Disney's largest creative peak, which was around Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, Lion King, and so on and so forth. He didn't score every single one of those movies, but he did several of them and contribute to the words and the songs that are quite memorable. Okay, next up, Hans Zimmer and Pharrell Williams are named Oscar Music Supervisors. So, Kevin, did you have a chance to check this out, this article?
I did a little bit. This is kind of an announcement that has kind of popped up all over the place this week as the announcement was made. I think it'll be an interesting choice. It's certainly a different approach than what they usually go with. You oftentimes have, some Hollywood composer who kind of does most of the arrangements and also conducts the orchestra there for the show. I know William Ross has done it several times over the past few years. Michael Giacchino did it just a couple years ago. But, you know, Hans Zimmer, who we certainly don't think of him as the kind of, you know, acoustic orchestral conductor type composer, but certainly more of a recording studio electronic kind of composer. And then, of course, Pharrell Williams, who's a rapper and a producer and things like that. Certainly kind of a different approach to music for this year's Oscars. It'll be kind of interesting to see how that turns out and how much of the music for the show will actually be from a live orchestra as opposed to something, you know, pre-recorded.
Well, that should be interesting. Mm-hmm. All right. Next up, the Broadcast Film Critics Association has named Martin Scorsese the second recipient of its Music Plus Film Award. So this is kind of interesting. I wasn't even fully aware of this until recently.
Yeah.
But this award is this is pretty cool because they take a look at who's a filmmaker who has the ability for good storytelling plus the good use of music. As they say, quote, that the award, quote, honors a single filmmaker who has touched audiences through cinematic storytelling and has heightened the impact of films through the brilliant use of source and original music. And if anyone has seen Hugo, they know that it's a great opportunity for Howard Shore, and he took the advantage of the setting, the visual element, the magical element, and I thought the movie was fantastic, and of course the score was really perfectly suited for it. So Scorsese is being honored, and I think that's very cool because at this point he pretty much deserves whatever's out there because of the quality you get from him. Kevin, have you had a chance to see Hugo?
You know, I have not gotten out to the theater to see it yet. You said you saw it, what, last week? Is that right?
Yes. Yes.
Did you see it in 3D?
3D. Best use of 3D that I've ever seen.
Okay.
In any of these movies. But I never saw Avatar in 3D, but I saw Avatar, and that was enough to not want to see it again. But I saw this, and I had not really watched a lot of trailers or seen commercials for it. I just thought that it sounded interesting from word of mouth, and so I wanted to go check it out, and it was well worth my time. So, and it's well worth your time as well, especially if you love film, then it is perfectly suited for you. Now, earlier this year, January specifically, John Barry, film composer well known for James Bond Legacy, as well as sort of various genre films, whether it's dramas like Out of Africa and winning an Oscar for that, or Dances with Wolves with Kevin Costner, mm-hmm. or Disney's science fiction outing, The Black Hole, and creating sort of a large Star Wars-like kind of score for that, had passed away in January. And there's an article that we have linked through our website where David Arnold, who now has sort of picking up the torch to carry for the James Bond scores, just has a sort of a remembrance for John Barry. It's a link to an article on The Guardian. So you can read that. It'll be linked through our website. Very quick mention. We all know, if we're following films as they're being made, that right now Superman is being filmed in various places in Canada and in the US, and Zack Snyder's directing it. And if you check IMDb, I believe you'll still see that John Williams is listed as providing themes for it. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. Have you checked it recently, Kevin? No one's named.
I think I just looked at it just last week, and it just had John Williams listed as, like you said, the composer of the themes. Now, we had mentioned that going back, I think, a few months, that his name showed up there, and the themes part wasn't attached. So it was exciting, like, oh, John Williams is going to score the new Superman movie. But then later on, it has turned into John Williams, composer of the themes. So.
Right.
Whether that means he's going to be doing it or someone else is going to be just using his thematic material like John Ottman did a few years ago. But another composer has not shown up on the IMDb page yet, as far as my last checking of that.
Okay, well, at IndieWire.com, they talk to Hans Zimmer because, of course, right now he's out and about to talk about, I just had it a second ago, I couldn't remember what movie was.
Probably talking about Sherlock Holmes.
Sherlock Holmes, right. Yeah. So he's got the Sherlock Holmes coming out. And of course, he's being associated with it, whether he wants to be or not, simply because Christopher Nolan, whom he collaborates with on the Batman movies, is, of course, overseeing the movie while Zack Snyder directs it. And so he was approached. Basically, the article is, it's kind of a lot of nothing, because Hans Zimmer doesn't say yes, he's doing it, but he doesn't say no, he's not. But it would seem that he's very busy and, it, as of right now, is not taking on the project. So yeah. This is definitely something to just watch out for if you care about the movie or what Hans Zimmer does. It's definitely interesting to see where this goes from here, because he could be playing
with. Yeah, like you said, his name has kind of been kicked around with that project for a long time. Not only, like you said, because of his association with Christopher Nolan and the whole DC superhero movie thing, but also just given the nature of the types of movies that Zack Snyder directs, you know, a lot of the composers he has worked with in, say, you know, like The Watchmen or 300 or something like that, all are kind of in that Hans Zimmer electronica kind of vein. So there's for a long time been a lot of talk about Hans Zimmer and Superman. And I mentioned to you before the show, there was an interview with him that was from maybe early on in the summer. It was earlier this year, I think, and someone had been asking him about Superman. And he basically said, there's no way I would even want to try to kind of follow in the footsteps of John Williams scoring Superman, because his 1978 score to Superman was so iconic. He said, I wouldn't even want to touch that. And so this is kind of another case of him just basically saying, no, I'm not going to be doing it. On this article on IndieWire, he basically says, I've got something else that I'm going to be working on then, whether he is or not, you know, who knows, but that's kind of his out, is that, I'll be busy, and just kind of another chance for him to say, no, I'm not doing it. But people will still ask him, I'm sure.
Yeah. Always. Okay. Next up, if you would like to talk to Danny Elfman or ask Danny Elfman a question, you may get the chance. Coming up on December 16th at 11:30 a.m., there's going to be a live web chat with Danny Elfman. It's going to be hosted by Culture Monster. And basically, it's an opportunity where you can just kind of jump in and you sign up, ask some questions, maybe engage some conversation. Who knows? So we'll have the links on our website again, which is always soundnotion.tv/SAP. And this should be, let's see, our producer was asking what time zone this is. I'm going to guess West Coast. It doesn't say.
When I found this article, I don't think I was able to find it anywhere. It's in the LA Times, so I'm assuming it's Pacific.
Oh, time. Okay. Okay. Los Angeles Times on December 16th at 11:30 a.m. So that's, I would say, 99%
2:30 Eastern. Is that right? Okay. 2:30 Eastern time, 11:30 Pacific.
All right, and let's see. The movies on the radio, if you pay attention to that show, if you tune into that, they're going to have Michael Giacchino for a live conversation. Let's see, this is going to be...
I think, was it Saturday night? I know we mentioned movies on the radio a couple, maybe 3-4 weeks ago. They had done...
Okay.
An episode playing some unreleased or some new music from Warhorse and Tintin, and it was kind of the first chance for most of us people without those kind of connections to hear something. And so, mm-hmm. Yeah, this Saturday their show will be the host will be interviewing Michael Giacchino because of the upcoming Mission Impossible movie that he scored for Brad Bird, which should be interesting. I'm kind of thinking about going to see it for no other reason than I want to see the Dark Knight Rises intro at the beginning of the film, but we'll see.
Yes, they're going to have the first 6 minutes, and already some bloggers are writing about it, and I'm trying not to read any of it because they already just released the the teaser poster for it with Bane, and well, I won't tell you what else is in it. It's on the internet.
See, Bill, I'm the opposite of you. I try to dig up any information I can. I have no problem having my spoilers, you know, running into spoilers.
It depends on what the property is, because for some reason I had to read every Star Trek script I could find just so I know they didn't screw up the next movie. Uh-huh. And it wasn't good enough because I'd read the script and sometimes they weren't correct. They weren't like fan-made scripts that someone said was real. But other times I found them like well before the movie came out and they were dead on with detail and everything. And I was kind of like, oh, this will be bad. And it's unfortunate. But anyway, with the Batman stuff and Nolan, I want to stay away from just because he's got a pretty good batting average so far, and I just want to kind of
You don't feel the need to check up on him, make sure he's doing it right? Give him a phone call and tell him if he's doing something wrong, right?
I already know what one of the vehicles is going to look like, and that was actually really hard to avoid just by reading about movies. Yeah. They're like, oh, hey, here's a – oh, wait, it's a spoiler – okay, now that you know it's a spoiler, here's this big...
here's this big image you can't avoid.
Here's this big vehicle, and it's like, stupid.
All right.
Anyway.
Cool. So why don't we go ahead and move on to our best holiday score list.
What's that?
I said, why don't we move on to our best holiday score list here? This one, you know, we did this, at the end of October for Halloween. Bill, I don't know, but to me it seemed like this one was a little bit harder to put together than the Halloween list. I don't know.
Well, I mean, there's a whole genre of horror movies, and there's not really a genre of Christmas movies because they tend to be seasonal, but we don't tend to go see them for any exciting thrills, and you definitely don't take your girlfriend to it so that she can get scared and grab you like she does a horror movie.
Right. It seems like the horror genre is a little bit more specific, and the holiday Christmas is a little tougher to define because it's a little larger. So,
first up on our list of Christmas scores that have Christmas moments, or scores that make us think of Christmas, or some other large category,
or just have snow.
The scores that just have snow, or Glockenspiel. and a couple of strings, as we'll get to a little bit later. This actually, the first one is kind of funny because it's generally not all the way through a Christmas movie, but it does have a couple moments in it that are Christmassy. And this first one is Babe, the movie from, I want to say, 1997 or 98. Don't quote me on the year. We're too busy here to look this stuff up.
Right.
So
don't come here for facts.
I'll leave it up to our listeners to email us the correct year. Anyway, so this score, the movie, of course, was not American. It was mostly kind of a New Zealand film. The composer was not a well-known Hollywood name, a composer by the name of Nigel Westlake. And he wrote a fantastic score that incorporates the theme to Camille Saint-Saëns' Third Symphony. So that's found in the score. That's nice. But another melody that he worked in was Jingle Bells. But let me preface this excerpt before we play it. The main character, Babe, our pig, has just been told that pork, which is what he is made of, is a nice sweet meat, and that
it's delicious.
He should be expected that he's going to be eaten for the Christmas dinner. So we get a rather scary rendition of Jingle Bells, or a rather demented version of Jingle Bells, which is rather, I think, really enjoyable. And then it's immediately followed with sort of the sunrise of the next day, which is Christmas morning. And then Westlake more or less plays it straight. So we'll actually hear two versions in this short excerpt. So this is a quick clip from the score to Babe by Nigel Westlake. All right, so there's Babe. Next.
Some demented Jingle Bells.
Yeah.
The next one on our list is the John Debney score to Elf, directed by Jon Favreau from just a few years ago. This is the newest film on our list by quite a few years, I think. I don't think there's anything particularly, you know, fantastic about this particular score. It just happens to be one of those scores that I think fits the film very well. We're going to listen to just a little bit of the main title theme music here. There are a few different musical textures that come about through this film. Most of them are kind of a goofy, bouncy, cartoony accordion kind of thing that fits the nature of Will Ferrell's character quite a bit. The part we're going to hear, though, is the more, I don't want to say more serious, maybe the more like sentimental main theme, I guess, if you want to think of it that way. So let's listen to a little bit of the main title from John Debney's score to Elf.
Yeah, that sounded a lot like the Sibelius Symphony 5, actually. It had that very similar melody mm-hmm. contour.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or the last movement of Sibelius 5. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
But all you got to do is just put Jingle Bells behind it.
Seriously, how many of the ones on our list sound Christmassy just because they either have Jingle Bells or Celeste or both? I mean,
well, it's funny that you mentioned those instruments because that segues perfectly to this next example, Kevin.
Wow.
This is one that most people probably have no idea what it is or where it comes from. But Amazing Stories was a show that Steven Spielberg starred in the mid 1980s to partner sort of A-list Hollywood directors along with really, really good I'm trying to think of the word that means, like, not ubiquitous, but prominent film composers. Anyway, And so Spielberg did a few episodes with his own partner, John Williams. Tim Burton did a few episodes with Danny Elfman. Robert Zemeckis did some episodes with Alan Silvestri. This episode was called Santa 85 because it was 1985 when it came out, and it dealt with Santa Claus being arrested and taken to jail, and some kids get together to save him. And it's scored by Thomas Newman before his sort of film scoring career took off and he was very famous and well-known. However, it didn't mean that his style was any different, because here he explores a lot of color like he does later in his scores. So when we start this, you'll hear some melodic material in the flutes, but a lot of really cool, just everything you would associate with Christmas, snow, wintry, cold weather. But it still has some charm and some warmth to it. So here's a little excerpt from the first track from Santa 85 by Thomas Newman.
You put a little bit of that glockenspiel in there, and all of a sudden it becomes Christmassy.
That's right. Right. Tremolo the strings and instant Christmas.
Right. It's like the spice pack that comes with ramen noodles. It's like, oh, all of a sudden it's chicken. Okay. The next score on our list, I think it was The next score we have on our list is, for me anyway, was one of the easiest ones to come up with for this list. And this is the Vince Guaraldi score for the original Charlie Brown Christmas special. It's an interesting score, I think, for a couple of reasons. It's just a jazz trio and occasionally a children's choir. But it's a score that is not known for its production value. It is not the most highly polished studio recording. In fact, my understanding of it is that the score was recorded in Guaraldi's basement studio, and the piano, the day they were recording, the piano was just out of tune, and that's what ended up in the score. So let's listen to Christmas Time Is Here, which is one of the songs that we see in the film. This one, I think, is the instrumental version without the children's choir. I find this one, Bill, to be an interesting example because, you know, we were just talking about sleigh bells and glockenspiel and things that composers can do to make a score sound Christmassy. But you take a look at most of the songs, most of the pieces in the score for this film. You know, if you take out like Hark the Herald Angels Sing and the other Christmas Carol songs, it's a jazz trio. And especially when there's no singing, there's really nothing musically going on to suggest Christmas. But because this music, at least for me, and I think is the case for most people, because this music is so closely associated with the Charlie Brown Christmas special, it's, even though there's nothing inherently Christmassy about the music, you still react that way when you hear it. It still sounds like Christmas music, even though there's nothing necessarily in the music that should make it sound like Christmas music.
Well, on the one hand, we've been trained because we know it, right, and we're familiar with it. On the other hand, there is a connection with the sort of vocal, like caroling, and something really kind of cold sounding about children's choir whenever they sing, like not cold, like icy and unemotional, but just sort of a cold
Christmas pageant cold,
like a kind of a, like a hollow sound that, and sometimes is beautiful. but is sometimes in an orchestrational way is reminiscent of like layers of white snow rather than, you know, warm sunlight. So children singing in this higher register when they come in, not in this version, the instrumental, of course, but the original that's used on the show, when they're singing Christmas Time Is Here, it does really kind of lend itself to the holidays. Just the vocal element does take over for me and kind of do that. That's actually a big point I wanted to make in this next excerpt. When Danny Elfman came back to the Batman sequel with Tim Burton, Batman Returns, they not only had the Penguin as the villain, but they set it during Christmas time. So the whole opening credit is the whole main title is sort of a montage that shows the birth of the Penguin. And so you get to see the villain's origins. And one of the things that Elfman does is he presents all the sort of cold colors of the orchestra get a chance to shine, like the strings in the high register, sort of a children's choir, or if not children, definitely like a treble choir, like all women. But I think it's children's choir as well. And then you get, I think it, in the excerpt I have, there's even some sleigh bells in the background. So this is a little excerpt from the very beginning of the score to Batman Returns by Danny Elfman, and I believe it's The Birth of the Penguin. Yep. So definitely kind of dark and twisted, a little bit like the example from Babe earlier. So
yeah,
we've not only got Christmassy music, but we've got twisted Christmas music too.
This is going to sound maybe kind of ridiculous, but it's actually, you know, this example actually has a lot in common with the next one we're going to listen to. But for me, as I said, this is probably going to sound stupid and not make any sense. Christmas music in a minor key sounds different to me than other music in a minor key, if that makes any sense. There's something strange but kind of cool that happens when you have Christmas music in a minor key, and I'm not exactly sure what it is. I don't know if there's anything really different about it. It just somehow strikes me different. Maybe it's just some kind of, I don't know, psychobabble. I don't know. The next score that I want to talk about is right from around the within a year or two of Batman Returns, and this is John Williams' score to the first Home Alone. It's an interesting score. You know, a few of the films we've talked about have either used more wintry, you know, instrumental colors, but like you had mentioned, or incorporate a lot of, you know, Christmas carols or something like that. And there are a few moments in Home Alone where there are Christmas carols. But for this score, a lot of the main themes that John Williams has come up with seem to be kind of Christmas carols of their own. Like, he's almost written his, not only has he kind of written his own version of Christmas carols for the score, but he's not just using them thematically, he's using them, you know, in bits and pieces motivically throughout the score. So we're gonna listen to, this is actually from one of the main tunes from the film. This is comes from a piece that he wrote that you see the children's choir singing towards the end of the film. The tune called The Star of Bethlehem. So let's take a little listen to this one from Home Alone.
Thank you.
I wanted to hear that last little cadence there.
Sorry, anyway. Yeah. We cut that off a little early there. I brought in the fade too soon. Again, there's some creepy, minory thing that, when used in something Christmassy, doesn't, I don't know if it maybe just sounds less dark than in other contexts or something. I don't know. It's kind of, do you have any idea what I'm talking about? Am I making any sense whatsoever?
Well, on one hand, no, but on the other hand, I can guess.
Okay.
And I think that some of the old Christmas carols that have, you know, they're less about Christmas and more about the sort of the biblical representation that the religious carols and whatnot. You know, that's almost, those are almost half and half. I mean, like half, like you have,
oh, Joy yeah. to the,
but then you have like, We Three Kings or, right.
As you know, as a church organist myself, I'm playing more hymns in a minor key this time of year than any other time, you know, except for maybe Lent.
But I think it comes from, I mean, there are some, you know, English carols that are just, you know, like maybe we're English and we're depressed, so we're going to have our carol in a minor key. But I also think that some of them may be trying to evoke the Middle Eastern thing through a minor scale. And I mean, We Three Kings is kind of obvious. So I think they, on some maybe very vague level, they might be trying to evoke the kind of the exoticness of that. But anyway, let's move on. So we've got, let's see, Home Alone. One that I wanted to look at kind of takes the minory sound, minory sound, that's an official
it's
term.
It's a word. That works.
We coined it right here just now. Yeah. It kind of sounds minory.
Somebody write down the date and time.
This is another Danny Elfman entry, and it's not necessarily a Christmas movie all the way through, but it's Edward Scissorhands, and the reason I chose this was because there's a lot of imagery in this movie where Edward, of course, comes from, you know, he's isolated and he comes down and he decides to sort of sculpt ice displays. And as a result of him doing that, as is explained in the movie, that's where snow comes from, especially in this suburban area. It's a very charming score. It's very light, except for a few dramatic moments where awful things happen to Edward and from Edward. But in some of the opening music that sets the stage in a very Once Upon a Time kind of feel, we get a nice sort of like 3-4 idea. So it's like a waltz. It's just in three, and we have singers, so it has a sort of holiday sound. We have sort of glistening sounds of the orchestra, strings, harp, celesta, so mallets, in other words, mallet percussion, and flutes. And so you get this, again, this sort of glistening shine to the use of the orchestra, and he saves low brass and horns for more explosive moments. So let's listen to a little bit of the opening from Danny Elfman's Edward Scissorhands. There it is again. We got voices, we've got strings, we've got celeste.
Yep.
Yeah.
Maybe sleigh bells in there somewhere. I wasn't really paying attention. Sorry.
Probably.
Yeah. All right. The next one on our list is probably one of the most iconic Christmas movies out there. This is the 1966 How the Grinch Stole Christmas. Not a ton of background score per se, but, you know, within this 26-minute film, quite a few songs, music written by songwriter, composer Albert Haig. So let's just listen to a little bit of one of the songs from How the Grinch Stole Christmas.
Fa-hoo-fa-ray's, welcome Christmas, bring your light. Fa-hoo-fa-ray's, welcome in the
Yeah, and you know, like we've been talking about through for this whole topic. A lot of the same instrumental colors kind of show up in this, you know, sort of tinkly, shiny glockenspiel and all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But lots of iconic music from that film, of course, mostly, as I mentioned, mostly songs.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's been kind of funny because we've had some music that I said, oh, you know, in Babe, it's kind of dark, and in Batman Returns, it's sort of twisted. But for my money, it doesn't get darker with the humor than the first Gremlins movie, because I got to tell you, I think the movie was way ahead of its time. It has a certain wonderful, charming sarcasm and just a real dark black comedy kind of feel to it. That's just really actually quite wonderful. And I hate all those parent groups that complained about this movie because they shouldn't have taken their kids to see it, quite frankly, even though it helped create the PG-13 rating along with Temple of Doom. So Jerry Goldsmith wrote the music for Gremlins and kind of has like a ragtime thing for the Gremlins. But what we're going to hear is, well, of course, he has that. He has the theme for Gizmo, the nice, warm, fuzzy, friendly Mogwai, who turns into gremlins or pops them out of his fur because he got wet and you didn't follow the rules. So if you don't know what I'm talking about, see the movie. It'll all make sense. Now,
if you've never seen the movie, then the things that Bill is saying are just complete gibberish.
It's just gibberish. That's what happens most of our episodes anyway. Yeah, but okay. What we're going to hear a little excerpt of here is, so not only does Goldsmith need to sort of paint the time, because this entire movie takes place around Christmas, but he uses, rather than celesta or strings or any of these, I mean, of course he has strings because it's an orchestral score, but he really relies on a lot of synthesizers, as was a common trademark in his scores, especially in the 70s, 80s, and 90s. So let's listen to a little excerpt. This is at the opening of the film, and it kind of follows the Gizmo or Mogwai theme. So you're going to kind of come in on the cusp of that. And this is really almost a study just in texture. So you're going to hear a little bit of strings and some synthesizers mixed in. And I still think you get kind of an atmosphere of cold, chilly, and wintry. So let's check out this excerpt from the opening of Gremlins by Jerry Goldsmith. Yeah, a lot of bells in there too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you throw some chimes in there that kind of automatically gives something kind of a Christmassy sort of thing too.
Yeah, definitely.
All right, the last item on our list here is from the 1983 film, the classic Christmas movie, A Christmas Story. I find that the score to this film pretty interesting. I mean, whenever I see this film, you know, it's set in the 1940s. I kind of always have a hard time remembering that this movie's from 1983. It strikes me as a much older movie, and I think a lot of that has to do with the way that it's scored. You know, there of course a very famous scene in the film with the little orphan Annie secret Dakota ring and kind of sitting by the radio listening to the episodes. So there's this very old-fashioned sort of 1940s quality about it. And the music is sort of treated that way. The music sounds almost like from, you know, like a 1930s or 40s Warner Brothers cartoon. A lot of it is very zany, wacky kind of stuff. We're going to listen to a little bit of a cue from the end of the film. This is where the Bumpuses, the next door neighbor, their dogs just come tearing through the house and eat up the Christmas turkey and all this stuff, and the family ends up having to go eat Christmas dinner at a Chinese restaurant. So let's listen to a little bit of music from A Christmas Story.
Well, you don't get more Christmassy than that.
It's just so ridiculous and cartoony and awesome. I love how there are dog barks written into the music as a part of the musical texture as the dog returns from these kitchens. It's fantastic. And you know, no Christmas movie list could be complete without talking about the Christmas Story anyway.
That's right.
So I'm sure we've left out plenty of Christmas and holiday movies that people would have liked us to mention, but these are the ones that we like, so that's what we're going with.
But if there was something that was an egregious error, write to us and let us know that we missed it.
Yeah.
But if it's Nightmare Before Christmas by Danny Elfman, we've already thought about it and
we decided to
include it.
That's so, right.
Yeah,
feel free to write to us and let us know if we missed something. That way we can ignore it.
Or at least acknowledge it if we feel like it's worth acknowledging.
Right.
All right.
But present.
Okay. So this week and things we've seen, Kevin, anything interesting that you've seen?
Yeah, I started for the past couple of weeks now. I've started watching the new AMC series called Hell on Wheels. It's about a handful of characters, but they're basically living in this little shanty town. As a crew building the Union Pacific Railroad. It's kind of an interesting show. I want it to be a really good show. I just feel like it's moving kind of slow. But the music in it is kind of interesting, particularly the theme music. It's set in like post Civil War U.S., like early 1870s. But the theme song is very heavy with there's some like background percussion, like foot stomping and that sort of thing. But it's mainly played on a dobro, which is an acoustic guitar with a steel resonator in the body of the guitar. It makes for some very interesting music. I personally feel like it's not super timely. I think when I think of a dobro, I think more of like, you know, 1912, like blues guitar kind of thing, and not necessarily 1870. But it's pretty cool. It's got some, you know, the music is treated interestingly in the series. It's worth checking out. What about you, Bill?
This week I rented the Conan the Barbarian remake. I'm kind of a fan of the original, only because not so much Schwarzenegger, but just that the original is kind of this large epic. It's got a huge canvas. It's pretty well shot, and it's got a great sort of epic cinematic and operatic score by Basil Poledouris. So it's kind of hard to make those comparisons and not come out a little disappointed. But I wanted to see what this new one would do. I mean, the guy, the new Conan, is he's physically definitely the part. Acting-wise, I just don't know. I mean, I want to say he wasn't that good, but I'm sure some of it's direction or writing. I want to feel the same thing about the score. Tyler Bates wrote the score, and like a lot of things these days, even if the movie itself seems to want to have a lot of personality, which I'm really not sure that they were after that with this remake. I think they just wanted to, basically, I think they just wanted to cash in on the name brand familiarity, because it's kind of a very by the numbers movie. And the score felt kind of like it was just the type of score to score that type of movie. So every time there's a large scene, the orchestra plays with really big chords, and that's about all you get. And I didn't notice anything memorable about it. I don't want to diss Tyler Bates too much. I think in this case, he was probably doing his job. He was probably doing exactly what he was hired to do. And like when we had Lucas Kendall before on our show, the idea was that, you can't take away from the reality of the movie. You can't detract from the audience's experience by having a melody in there that they're going to remember. Of course, I think they probably said the same thing about you can't interfere with the reality of Conan by having a melody. How dare you? So the irony being that there is no reality in this movie. It's so over the top, and it's basically like a comic book movie, just sort of sword and sandals approach. But, you know, just sort of Carmina Burana, but minus all the melodies from the Orff. Just big sounds, lots of percussion, lots of strings and brass. It used the full orchestra with voices. So, I mean, that's cool. Put a lot of musicians to work, as long as it's not samples. But it was kind of bland, and that was unfortunate, but I'm sure Tyler has the ability to do something great. This just was not the movie for him to do that. So that was what I saw this week.
All right. So for our last segment, today. You know, we already mentioned this score a little bit. We're going to listen to a small clip from Home Alone. You know, we've kind of been going back and forth with this whole if you like this format where we play something from a film score that sounds kind of like a something from a concert piece or from something else entirely. But given that this is our Christmas episode, we're going to go with Home Alone. Now, of all of the different if you like this pairings that we've talked about, Bill, I think this one is maybe the closest one that we've gotten. This particular music from Home Alone sounds so much like this particular piece of music from Nutcracker. In a lot of ways, it's very difficult to differentiate between the two. Harmonically, it's very similar. Melodically, it is crazy, crazy how close it is. Even the orchestration, if you listen to the whole cue and you listen to the whole Trepek Russian dance from Nutcracker, it even follows the same sort of orchestrational roadmap.
What about rhythm, Kevin?
Well, of course, the rhythm and the tempo and the energy, everything. So let's go ahead and listen to...
Rhythm's pretty much the same.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's this very furious sort of 16th note thing. This is from the part of the film. It's used in a few different places, but early on in the film, as the family is getting ready for their big travel trip, you see this sort of fast motion, everyone running up and down the stairs and furiously running about the house. So let's listen to the John Williams version first. All right, so that is going to do it for this episode of Streamers and Punches. You can listen to us on soundnotion.tv/SAP, where you can subscribe to our show, leave comments, find the links to a lot of these different things we've been talking about. You can also subscribe to our show through the iTunes store. Feel free, as we mentioned before, if we missed any important Christmas holiday scores that you thought should have been included on our list, feel free to let us know about that. As we wrap up tonight's show, again, we're going to listen to the Trepek dance from Tchaikovsky's Nutcracker Suite. You know, very, very similar to what we just heard from Home Alone. This particular recording happens to be Leonard Bernstein and the New York Philharmonic, and it's probably the fastest version of this movement that I've ever heard, and it only gets faster as it goes along. And as far as I'm concerned, this is how it should be performed because it's just kind of out of control, and it's a lot of fun. So. Thanks again for watching. We'll see everyone next week. My name is Kevin Wilt.
And I'm Bill Witham.
Thank you for listening.